Good morning, Crosspoint Church. How's everybody?
Yeah, just in time, Tawdry. I made it. Everybody stand on your feet if you would.
Just in time.
I was a little late to the party. I hadn't even taken my gum out. Is that okay with everybody? My name is Jesse. I'm glad that you're here this morning. I'm one of the pastors here at Crosspoint Church. If this is your very first time ever at Crosspoint Church, we are super glad. We're glad that everybody in this room's here. But if this is your first time here, we're extra glad that you're here. And there's a whole lot of people that got up this morning and came prepared to serve you. So if there's something we can do for you, please let me know. I would be happy to take care of you. Let me know what I can do for you. We got a gift for you for being our first time guest on the way out if you didn't get it on the way in. Who's ready to sing with us this morning? All right, that was kind of weak. And I mean, I love you. I'm not like making fun of you or nothing. I'm just saying, you know, let's bring a little energy to the party. You ready? All right, you guys sing with us. Love you, people.
With open hearts and lifted hands, we wait for you to move again. Here and now, make your presence known. With the darkness flee and the giants fall, let your kingdom come as we surrender all. Here and now, make your presence known.
Here we go.
King of heaven, you are welcome in this place. We want to see your kingdom come. Kingdom come.
going, Wes. Come on, Crosspoint, put your hands together. We did this in last week. We had some baptism last week. For all those who are baptized, raise your hands in the air. Oh, we got some to go. Love it. Keep clapping.
I know a place where we can go to lay the troubles down, even your soul. I know a place where mercy flows, that takes the stains and make it whiter than snow. And like a tide, it is rising up deep inside the current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, 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 we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river to breathe. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water, and rise up in amazing breeze. Let's is rising up deep inside the current that moves and makes you come alive. Living water that brings the dead to life. Oh, we're going down to the river, down to the river, down to the river. Let's get washed by the water, washed by the water. Rise up in amazing grace. Let's go perfect love cast out all fear. And in you, Jesus, I am victorious. I am fearless. I am victorious.
You guys can just remain seated, but in just a moment we're going to bring our tithes and give our offering. And as we do that today, we're going to pray over these shoeboxes. You guys have so generously brought these shoeboxes back in here. It was nearly 200 boxes this time, because this is not all of them for sure. And here's what I know. You guys have done a good job. You've gone out to the store and you have filled these things with toys and crayons and candy maybe, and I don't know what you put in there. But here's what I want to remind us of right now, is that all that stuff's fun, and it's good. It feels good, right, to be generous to people who wouldn't have anything otherwise. But beyond just toys and stuff, every one of those boxes represents an opportunity for some kid in some other part of the world to get the gospel for Christmas. And that's a big deal. Every one of those boxes is a representation that some kid might be able to pass from death to life, receive faith, trust Jesus for the forgiveness of his sin where he might not otherwise. And I want us to remember that right now. So bow your heads with me if you would. Let's pray over these boxes, that God through the Holy Spirit would use every one of these in his sovereignty to draw little children across the world to himself. God, we love you, and we acknowledge that you and you alone are the author, perfecter of our faith. It begins with you and only you. And God, we're grateful for these people who are generous with their stuff, but even more now, we pray that you would use every one of these boxes to draw people to yourself, that they would find faith. You would give that to them as a gift. They would find forgiveness of their sin, God, and they would be changed forever. God, I pray that you use the children that are affected by these boxes to spread the gospel all over the world. We love you. Thank you for being generous to us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. You guys can be seated.
I just wanted to stop everything and take the time today to let you know how very thankful I am that you've been there for me.
I want to say thanks for never giving up on me.
Thank you for providing meals for us after Blake's surgery.
Thanks for making sure I always had a ride to chemo.
And thank you for helping me through this difficult season in my life, God.
Thank you, God, for teaching me to be a strong single dad.
Dear God, thank you so much for giving me this new job. I love it.
Thanks for sending Jeff to take my shift last week so I could be with my family.
For keeping me company on the first day of school.
Thank you, God, for helping us get that bill paid.
Thank you, God, for the clothes on my back.
For giving me the courage to speak the truth.
Thank you for forgiving me.
For making my day better.
For giving my life a melody.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For every single day.
And one final thing, God. Thank you for always loving me. No matter what.
Good morning. Aren't we thankful that he loves us no matter what? Amen. Even when we have a lot of stuff going on and maybe we don't remember him as we should, or if we mess up. Anybody sinned this morning already? Raise your hand, sinners. All right. All you that didn't raise your hand, look at these other people. So there you go. Hope you are excited to be here this morning as I am as we start this new series called Thankful. Yes, I was in education for 20 years, and yes, I know there's an additional L on there, just so you know, right? So let me go, you know, there's an extra L on there that didn't really have that. Thankful. After you eat Thanksgiving dinner, you're going to be what? Full. After you eat lunch this afternoon, you're going to be what? What's the difference? About $100. So that's the difference, what you spend on Thanksgiving. But I am excited about this and a couple housekeeping things, actually just the one. My watch is not synced up this morning. It actually says 5 till 9. So good luck with that. I hope you had a big breakfast. The other thing is I want us to focus on the part about full. So you have this water. And how much is in here? There's always the one. Always the one. Two-thirds. Sort of. How about this way? You can look at it many different ways, but think about it when you go to a restaurant. If you drink this much of your drink, you're looking at your server like, I'm eating hot wings. I need some more drink. Make sure I got that. What? Full. Can I top you off? Yes, you can. Please do. Or if you're a sweet tea person like I am, sometimes you might drink 4 or 5 glasses of sweet tea at a meal. That's just how it rolls for me. And so we want to make sure that it's full. It's to the top. In living our lives in Christ and in our daily walk, how many times are we refueling? How many times are we hitting the full marker? How many times are we running on fumes? If we were our own server, feeling how much of the Holy Spirit we can get and feeling that we need to be closer to the Lord, what kind of tip would we give ourselves for how often we go to the Lord? Let's think about it that way. So there are a lot of different things we can talk about. The half empty, half full. even in circumstances that might make you go, oh, man. Anybody have a oh my moment this week? Anybody have just something that was just like, ah, what a blessed group. What a blessed group. I'll be teaching on honesty right after this series. So, but we have to look at the things we have to be thankful for. Just, for instance, anybody ever heard of reclaimed wood? Raise your hand. Barn wood. Expensive. You get all this reclaimed wood. I spent some time working with some reclaimed wood yesterday. So, was it very expensive? It was the wood that I had unloaded to split for firewood that the flood washed down through the woods. So I reclaimed it yesterday. And I had the tractor, and I went out, and I got on this tractor, and I'm driving in there, and I got this probably about 8 or 10 pieces up and got it back up to where it needed to be so I could split it. And then I decided that the other part was right near the woodshed. It was just like down this incline. So I thought, well, you know, it's really pretty solid. So I could just get right on down in there and load it up and just back it right out. It's four-wheel drive tractor, right? So as I go over the edge, it's not solid. It's a lot of leaves. You'd have thought somebody would have walked on it first, but they didn't. So I go and it goes poof, just like that. Four-wheel drive tractor, all four just digging her down. So Renee was gone. Chloe is hurriedly getting ready for work, and I just decided, she can handle it. So I said, hey, come get in the truck. I'm going to put this strap on here. I could have been mad, could have been frustrated, could have just jerked it out myself with the truck and had a mess, but I used the resource God supplied. I said, get in the truck, put it in four-wheel drive, tighten it up, and then go. So she starts to go, and it won't go. And then I'm almost out, and she lets off. She says, it's not really going. I said, go! Just encouraging her. And so the gravel starts flying, and she's sideways. And so proud, she just kept it showered down, boy. And I'm on the thing backing out, and we got it out. But had I been what I was years ago, I'd have just been mad and I'd have hooked it up and yanked it out and tore it up. But I just thought, you know what? I could have gone off head first, could have been hurt again, mead moments. Or I can just say, you know what? God, thank you for Chloe. I'm going to go put her on there. Renee was there. Should have been first in line. But be thankful. No matter what the circumstance. Bible says, in all things give thanks, no matter what it is. We have a hard time with that. Because we are taught by the world that it's only when things are rosy, it's only when things are top notch, when everybody's happy, there is no conflict, that we should just be thankful. Because you can have the perfect life, right? Right? We think we can, because all we got to do is get on social media. Everybody else is. Look at that Christmas tree. Wow, what an amazing job. And they've had theirs up since October. What are we waiting on? Maybe life? I don't know. But have you spent time thanking God lately as we move toward Thanksgiving and we're going to have that one day celebration that we give thanks? And the other thing is, have you written down your thoughts to God? When's the last time you wrote a letter like we saw? When's the last time you put sticky notes in your car to remind you of God's goodness? This morning we're going to be looking in 1 Chronicles chapter 16. In the Ark of the Covenant has been placed inside this large tent that David had built, and they have sacrificed and they have had burnt offerings, and David has named out people to lead worship for a time of just worshiping the Lord. And we'll be looking at verses 23 through 36 in the portion that reminds us of who God is and how we are to be. Maybe this wouldn't be a typical Thanksgiving scripture, but it's one that tells us that every day we should be thankful. The Bible says this, "Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Each day proclaim the good news that he saves. Publish his glorious deeds among the nations. Tell everyone about the amazing things he does. Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. The gods of other nations are mere idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty surround him. Strength and joy fill his dwelling. O nations of the world, recognize the Lord. Recognize that the Lord is glorious and strong. Give to the Lord the glory he deserves. Bring your offering and come into his presence. Worship the Lord in all his holy splendor. Let all the earth tremble before him. The world stands firm and cannot be shaken. Let the heavens be glad and the earth rejoice. Tell all the nations the Lord reigns. Let the sea and everything in it shout his praise. Let the fields and their crops burst out with joy. Let the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming to judge the earth. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Cry out, save us, O God of our salvation. Gather and rescue us from among the nations, so we can thank your holy name and rejoice and praise you. Praise the Lord, the God of Israel, who lives from everlasting to everlasting." Would you pray with me? Father, this morning as we move through your word, God, I pray that you would just move in the hearts and lives of your people. Lord, pierce their hearts with a desire to praise you more, to thank you more, and to live with a heart of thankfulness each and every day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, there is something that he is sharing in song and praise. He says, here's what we need to be doing. Let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Each day proclaim the good news that he saves. You may or may not agree, but attitude is important in gratitude. Attitude is important in gratitude. When we raise our children, and someone maybe hands them a dessert or something after a meal, some ice cream or some candy or a gift or something when they're younger and they don't yet know what to do, we go, say thank you. And they look up and they're, okay. Say thank you. Thank you. Heartfelt, isn't it? What a beautiful moment. But we try to teach them and they have to learn. But our attitude is important in how we give thanks. Our attitude is important in whether we are truly thankful. When we stop and pray before a meal, when we stop and give thanks for anything, we give thanks for the day. We give thanks for the people that God has allowed us to minister to or to be a part of their lives. Do we pray out of gratefulness and a grateful, thankful heart? Or do we pray to be praying? Do we pray to just say, well, Lord, thanks for the day. Thanks for this. Thanks for that. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Bye-bye. Till next time. Sometimes it comes across that way, doesn't it? It's just something that we do. I heard something this morning on the way, and I thought, wow, that's awesome. It said, be still, be thankful, be aware. Be still, be thankful, be aware. Are we aware of what God is doing every moment of our life? Every moment of our lives. He has something for us. He has something for us to do. He is blessing us. How many of you have been blessed this week? Raise your hand. Hopefully everybody. But see, sometimes we get it in our mind that we want to be blessed more than we already are because someone else is. We want to be blessed because you've blessed them with this. How about blessing me with one of those? Lord, how about blessing me with some of this? How about giving me some of that? Instead of going, I cannot be thankful enough for what you've already given me. Our attitude and how we thank the Lord and what we desire to be a part of our everyday life and what we desire to be a part of in ministry and what we desire to do for Him, our attitude is important in that. Hey, could you serve in, I guess, put me down, I'm in. We can't wait for you to start. Think about it. Even in the workplace when somebody says, hey, can you do this? I guess I can. What a great heart. Right? Anybody guilty of that? Don't raise your hand. I am. We all are, right? We all have those things, those times in our lives where we're like, oh, man. But our attitude is important, not just in everything else, but in gratitude. How we give thanks. If we stop long enough to say, God, thank you, truly, thank you. Thank you. I just want to stop and be quiet and be still and be aware of what you have given me. I think that's the part. Sometimes it's just, all right, pray. All right, give thanks. All right, check. Not that we actually went somewhere and made it home safely. We expect that to happen. We expect that no one's going to veer across the line and we're going to lose our life or our family. Yet we read about those things every day. We just expect we're not that person. We need to have that attitude of humility and truly being thankful. It says, let the whole earth sing to the Lord. Each day proclaim the good news that He saves. Exclaim and proclaim. Exclaim and proclaim the good news of what God can do through His Son Jesus, that He can save us from all this mess. He can save us from eternity in hell. He can bring us with Him in heaven forever. Proclaim that to everyone. It's not a secret that we just keep for ourselves and our family. Let everybody know. And sometimes God gives us those opportunities to share. And I was talking with someone this week and something that happened, and then one thing led to another. And the subject came up about the accident I was in. And that person said, boy, are you one lucky guy. You got two options there, right? You can go, whew, I know. Because I don't really want to get into all that stuff because I don't know where you stand. Or you can just jump in there and go, no. Luck had nothing to do with it. God saved my life. That's it. There are things, yes. There are things that come up every day that we choose, or we could proclaim a little, or we could just kind of exclude, not even do the whole exclamation, just a little exclude, and give God a little plug. But it could be a long discussion. Exclaim and proclaim the good news. What has he done for you? And that's how it begins. We just tell our story. You don't have to be an evangelist. You don't have to have the Bible memorized. Tell your story. When somebody says, man, how did you get through all that? I know y'all have been through a lot, and we all have stuff. But you just say, without the grace of God and what he's done through his son Jesus on the cross, I wouldn't be able to make it. I wouldn't be able to do it. We tell our story. We exclaim and we proclaim and write it down. Write it down. When's the last time you spent some time just writing something? You know, we make lists. I've got to do this. I've got to do that. I've got to make sure I get that done. Check this off. Write it down. Stop and just write a note to God. That's your homework for this afternoon, by the way. Before Monday morning. I hope you're haunted by it all day Monday if you don't do it. I hope it's in the back of your mind. Listen, it's that important. I want you to stop and just say, God, I want to tell you thank you for some things. I want to tell you where I am. I want to tell you where I would like to be. I want you to help me get there. I just want to write a note to you, God. You see, when we write it down, we have to be still. We have to focus. We have to listen. And we get to communicate. And when we do that and we stop and we write it down, then things begin to flow and God can speak to us. But we're normally not still enough or quiet enough during the times that we are giving thanks truly, the times that we are praying truly, that we can hear from him, that we can understand what we need to do. Write it down. I want you to do that today. Just spend a moment writing down. And I promise you, if you just take a moment, it will last longer than a moment, and you'll go, wow, I didn't realize I had been writing that long. Write it down. Then maybe tomorrow, write it again. And then maybe Tuesday, write it again. Before long, you're in the habit of writing it down. Writing down his praises, the things you are grateful for, and then it becomes something, God, I wish you would intervene in this situation. I want to pray for this. And then it becomes who you are. Write it down. And speak it often. Speak it often. It says, publish his glorious deeds among the nations. Tell everyone about the amazing things he does. Great is the Lord. He is most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. The gods of other nations are mere idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty surround him. Strength and joy fill his dwelling. Strength and joy fill his dwelling. See, when we are strong in the Lord, when our relationship with the Lord is strong, then we are filled with joy. And when we're just kind of out here on our own sometimes, and then, oh, we're close to the Lord today, but then tomorrow, and then next week, and then we had this other thing happen, and then we're just kind of like, I don't know where I am. I'm just kind of floundering. We're not filled with joy. When we're filled with his strength, we can live with joy. Does that change our circumstances? Do our lives become perfect all of a sudden? No. But we can have joy about it. We can have peace about it because of the strength that we have in God. His strength is made perfect in our weakness, the Bible says. So accept his strength. Accept his strength. Sometimes we cannot accept any help or strength from others And that could be called pride, because I want to do it on my own. Hey, let us help pay for this. Let us help you do that. Let us help. I got it. We're good. We can't let anyone think that we're vulnerable. We can't let anyone think that we can't make it. When maybe we are keeping other people from a blessing by allowing them to help us. Maybe we're keeping other people from a blessing by allowing them into our lives to help us walk through something. To help clean up a mess. To help get our feet back on the solid ground. So then, why don't we just submit and accept His strength? And if we accept His strength and we are filled with joy, then what else would we desire? See, circumstances are going to change. Things are going to happen. Life is going to come at us fast, just like the commercial, right? And we're going to see mayhem in our lives sometimes, right? As we take our eyes off of something, bam, there we are. But we have His strength and His joy, then everything's going to be okay. Because, reminder, spoiler alert, we're not living on this earth forever. We're passing through. This is not our home. So then, worship, worship, worship. O nations of the world, recognize the Lord. Recognize that the Lord is glorious and strong. Give to the Lord the glory He deserves. Bring your offering and come into His presence. Worship the Lord in all His holy splendor. Let all the earth tremble before Him. The world stands firm and cannot be shaken. What happens when the news comes on? Ah, the world's falling apart. I knew this was going to happen. Listen, He's in complete control. Complete control. The world may be out of control, but we're not part of this world. This world is not our home. This earth is not where we're going to wind up one day with Him. And we're not going to have be in worship of our one true Savior. The beginning of our eternity, whenever that is, whenever we leave this life and we're in the presence of the Lord. One day, we're not all going to be in heaven worshiping and go, oh my goodness, did you hear about the news? We interrupt this worship for, no, that's not how it goes. So why are we so stuck with what's going on here? We're to worship Him. Worship Him in the morning when you wake up. How many morning people are there here? How many of you wake up singing every morning? How many of you would prefer no singing until noon? Okay. You can worship in your heart. But we are to worship Him. Worship Him while we're driving. Worship Him while we're at work. Worship Him while we're at home. In our heart, and just be so thankful. And when we take the focus off of what we have going on and give thanks to Him for who He is, then it changes how we view our circumstances. We're so busy worshiping Him and giving thanks for what we've been blessed with, we don't have time for this junk to come in and tear us down and break us down. Let the heavens be glad and let the earth rejoice. Tell all the nations the Lord reigns. Let the sea and everything in it shout His praise. Let the fields and their crops burst out with joy. Let the trees of the forest sing for joy before the Lord. For He is coming to judge the earth. Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His faithful love endures forever. His love endures forever. His love endures. Does yours? Maybe in your family, maybe growing up, your family didn't tell each other how much they loved each other. Maybe you grew up in a family that if somebody left the house, they said, I love you. Maybe you grew up in a family that when you were on the phone before you hung up, you said, I love you. Maybe you tell each other that a lot. Maybe you don't. Maybe we should. But His love endures forever. Even when we're not exactly where we need to be, even when we're not doing exactly what we're supposed to do, even when we're on this journey to try to get it right and try to get back and we mess up, He still loves us. But do we show our love for Him in our worship, in being grateful, being thankful, even just to breathe? You see, here's the thing. If I said, all right, church, everybody, when I count to three, I want everybody to stop breathing for 5 minutes. Just stop. All right, ready? 1, 2, 3, go. Some of you are still breathing. You know why we can't stop breathing for 5 minutes? We can attempt to hold our breath. We can, as children sometimes do, they can get mad and go, well, I'm holding my breath there. And then you go, okay, and you just watch. He created this body so that that's an automatic reflex. We don't even have to think about it. When we go to sleep, we don't have to worry, well, what if I just stop breathing on my own during the night? Well, the only way that happens is if He calls you home. Normally we wake up, we are breathing, our heart is beating. He created us. He loves us. He wants us to be in relationship with Him. And that love endures forever. So we are to live in the faithful love of God. We are to live in the faithful love of God. His faithful love endures forever. Cry out, save us, O God of our salvation. Gather and rescue us from among the nations. Though we may be scattered throughout the world, and maybe we can carry our Bibles to church. Maybe we can carry our phones or our tablets in here and we can look at the Word. But in some places they can't. Some places they will face death for having even one verse of Scripture on them. People are afraid. That's not us. So we should be thankful and live in the faithful love of God because He loves us. And maybe one day, if we all live, we'll get to see Him just gather us up and take us on. And if we don't, then we'll already be in His presence anyway. But gather and rescue us from among the nations. Christians all over the world, gather us so that we can what? Thank Your holy name and rejoice and praise You. So we can thank Your holy name and rejoice and praise You. Praise the Lord, the God of Israel, who lives from everlasting to everlasting. And all the people shouted, Amen, and praise the Lord. Live in the faithful love of God and be filled with thanksgiving. Be filled with thanksgiving, not at Thanksgiving, but every day. Do you know how much less we would worry about the things we have, the stuff we desire, the things that other people have that we are envious of, or we wish we had that, or we wish we could do that, or we wish we could go here, or we wish we could go there. When we have been blessed immeasurably by God already, we have been blessed by what He desires that we have. If we were thankful, and we had an attitude of being humbled and thankful for all God has given us, It would change our entire perspective on how we see day-to-day life on this earth. So we're to be filled with thanksgiving. We're to praise His holy name. And you know, if we go back to the very last portion of that verse, in verse 36, it says, "Praise the Lord, the God of Israel, who lives from everlasting to everlasting." And all the people shouted, "Amen," and praised the Lord. There's a lot to praise the Lord for. Verse 35, cry out, "Save us, O God of our salvation. Save us, O God of our salvation." In a room this size, I know there must be some who say, you know, I've heard about Jesus, I've heard about the Lord, but I've never really made that decision. And I'm not sure if I want to walk this aisle during this song. I don't know what people will think. I don't know. Listen, if God's speaking to your heart, you better listen. You better be obedient. You better not wait. You better get it done. Last week, right after service, I've been talking with a mom and dad whose little girl had been asking some questions. And I thought, God, if we all could have that childlike faith. She just walked back right over here with her folks. I said, "Hey, what can I help you with? What can I pray with you about? What can I do?" Because I don't ever want to lead someone. That's God's job. She said, "I want to ask Jesus to come into my heart today." She didn't say, "Hey, I got some stuff to get cleaned up. My desk at school is messy. So when I get that cleaned up, I want to come back and ask you about having Jesus come into my heart. My book bag needs to be cleaned out. But then I want to ask Jesus to come into my heart." No. See, that's what we do as adults, isn't it? She said, "I want to give my heart to Jesus." And I said, "Well, we can do that right now, baby." And she did. And we just rejoice and thank you, Lord, for that today. As I pray right now, Father, for that one that's in here that says, "You know, I wish I had that childlike faith. I wish I didn't worry about what this might do for my relationship with someone else, or what would people think? I'm a first-time guest." Listen, people are going to think that God moved you, and we're going to rejoice and praise Him with you. So this morning, if you don't have a relationship with Christ, feel free to make your way to my right, your left, and be moved to salvation today. Today is the day of salvation. If you have other things going on in your life you need to pray about, you need to pray with a spouse, you need to bring your family, pray for our church, make your way. Pray for these children who will receive these shoe boxes. And thank you so much for your gifts and your time. God, move and be praised during this time of invitation, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand, please? Don't wait. Make your way. Don't wait. Make your way right now. Come on. Be obedient. Be obedient. All right. I trust you've been obedient to the Lord this morning. And I trust that you will leave this place today saying, Lord, help me to be more thankful. Lord, help me to be more still during the times that I am giving thanks. Help me not just to blast through it, but to focus on giving you thanks, Lord. I'll challenge you. Don't forget the challenge. Spend some time today writing down, just thanking God. If we would write down everything we have to be thankful for, it'd take a long time, wouldn't it? But let's just start today and write that down so that He would see that you are taking time to pause and not just check it off. In the circumstances that we have that are so tough, and many of us have situations going on, just go ahead and ask Him. After you thank Him, ask Him, Lord, intervene. He hears you. He knows you. He created you. He loves you. And His love endures forever. Be thankful for that. Amen. Amen.